Hey, Liz.
Where are you? Are you coming to the party?
No, you know what? I don't think I'm going to be able to go. I'm just so swamped tonight. Thanks for the invite, though. Bye. Who are you?
Are you sure you don't want to go to this party?
Did Liz send you?
The point is, you don't look very busy, and the party's only a few blocks away. Plus, you might meet somebody.
Yeah, but it's through a really bad part of town.
I'll walk with you.
What if someone put something in my drink?
I'll watch it for you.
And I don't like storms. I've heard that Hurricane Irma might reach us.
You know what? This sounds a lot like your anxiety might be talking.
No, these are legitimate fears.
Yeah, but they haven't happened yet. That's kind of the way anxiety works. But what exactly is the biology of anxiety, and how does it differ from fear? And more importantly, how do you overcome it? I'm no stranger to anxiety. Working in theater, I've come to be very familiar with the nervous jitters, the shortness of breath, and butterflies bordering on nausea that tend to precede most shows.
I fear my superstitions may run riot within me.
To better understand this meddlesome disorder, I decided to meet with Dr. Kristin Vickers, an expert who not only studies anxiety, but has had to battle with it for much of her life.
We all know what anxiety is, I guess, in an abstract way, but how do you define anxiety from a clinical perspective?
So one is anxious specifically about some sort of threat that will occur in the future. One would be anxious about an exam that's upcoming, for example. And in terms of it being clinically significant, it often amounts to, goes on for a long, long time, is disproportionate to the actual fear, causes significant distress for the person.
What's really the difference between fear and anxiety?
Fear is one's response to an immediate threat. Fear is when one confronts a phobic stimulus, something one is terrified of in the moment. Anxiety is a forward-looking apprehension about a threat.
But I thought fear and anxiety were the same thing.
Well, a lot of people do use them interchangeably, but the distinction is actually really important. Take fear. Say you were to walk into the woods at night and a bear jumped out at you.
Or a sketchy man in a dark alley.
Exactly. You would experience fear as the fight or flight response. According to John B. Watson, the father of behavioralism, fear is so primal, we're hardwired or born with it.
Okay, so what about my anxiety?
Anxiety is more of a learned response. It focuses on future dangers or potential threats. Your anxiety might make you avoid the alley because you imagine the sketchy man.
Yeah, well, at least my anxiety will keep me safe.
It's been argued that anxiety is actually adaptive and that we perhaps perform the best with a moderate degree of anxiety. That helps us plan. It helps us potentially stay out of trouble. Anxiety has a motivating function.
In prehistory, anxiety probably helped us stay alive by avoiding saber-toothed tiger and bear attacks. Today, it helps us stay out of shady alleyways and motivates us to study for exams in fear of failure. Although anxiety can be useful, too much of it can affect our ability to cope with stressful events. When anxiety becomes chronic or pathological, it can manifest as panic attacks or even phobias.
Specific phobias are these circumscribed fears of particular things, like my phobia of spiders. There's a irrationality that I can't even really articulate that permeates my fear of spiders. So you could just put a fake spider on the desk and you could watch me jump and scream and you would see me have a panic attack.
Why is it that the symptoms of anxiety feel so similar to fear? Maybe it's because they largely involve the exact same physiology. When our brains perceive any threat, whether or not it's real, it activates our sympathetic nervous system. Hormones like adrenaline and cortisol course through our body so we can deal with the threat. We experience rapid breathing, our hearts pound, and our senses heighten. But what about people who experience chronic or long-term anxiety?
In people who are chronically anxious, there's a physiological hyperarousal. People who are very anxious tend to be wound up. There's also sometimes an autonomic inflexibility.
What does that mean?
So it's actually advantageous health-wise to have some variability to your heart rate. For people with clinically significant anxiety, their heart rate would not tend to vary as much. It would kind of always be at a certain heart rate.
Okay, so I think I get it, but what's actually causing my anxiety?
Well, that's a bit complicated. A large part is caused by genetics, hormones, or childhood experiences, which can all predispose you to generalized anxiety.
Great, so those are all things that I can't control, so basically I'm screwed.
Not necessarily. Psychologist Stanley Schachter came up with the two-factor theory of emotion. Fear or anxiety has to be interpreted in a cognitive context, but that gets modulated by our experience.
Stanley who?
In other words, the specifics of our anxiety, so you getting anxious about the party or my stage fright, that gets explained by fear-based learning.
Anxiety, by definition, is learned through experience. When we get scared of something for the first time, whether or not that something is rational, new connections are formed within our brain, specifically the amygdala, where the fight or flight response is controlled, at receptors called NMDA.
This conditions fear memories, so we instinctively avoid those things we perceive as dangerous.
If we can learn to develop irrational anxiety, does that mean we can unlearn it?
There are fortunately some treatments available that can help people. Exposure can be a very effective therapy. So I could, in the context of spider phobia, it would be exposure to the spider. So I could be in a room with a spider, and then my body would calm down after a while. Eventually, if I stayed in the situation, I would learn that it's actually gonna get kind of boring. And repetition of that can lead to a reduction of fear. They learn via extinction that whatever catastrophe or core belief you have of a calamity, it's not gonna come true. People across the spectrum get anxiety disorders. And the good news is a lot of research has gone into empirically supported treatments that help a lot of people.
Countless studies have demonstrated that this specialized kind of cognitive behavioral therapy really does help people overcome most social anxieties and specific phobias.
Okay, I get it. So if I face my fears, I can beat my anxiety.
Exactly. So go have fun.
Facing your fears is a lot easier said than done, particularly if you have chronic, more generalized anxiety and don't even know what you're afraid of. I've learned to deal with mine by making peace with it. I've learned that anxiety will always find a way to creep into my life, and if it's there, it just means that I care. Yeah, I know, anxiety is very individual and affects us in different ways. In fact, why don't you share your stories or coping strategies in the comment section down below?
Ladies and gentlemen, places, please.
And don't forget to subscribe.